Let's swiftly move on to the next lecture on pediatric cardiology. May I invite the moderators for this lecture, please? Dr. Vasanthi Ratnayake, consultant cardiologist, and Dr. Sitija Vijayasinghe, consultant pediatric cardiologist, onto the stage, please. Thank you.
Warm welcome to the pediatric cardiology lecture. Our speaker today, Dr. Duminda Samarasinghe, MBBS, DECH, MD, FSCC, Senior Consultant Pediatric Cardiologist, Lady Ridgeway Hospital, the immediate past president of Sri Lanka Heart Association, the chairman, Children Heart Project of Sri Lanka, project director, Little Heart Project. And he has produced many pediatric cardiologists to Sri Lanka and publication done to national and international, and had contributed many support to the Sri Lanka Heart Association and Sri Lanka College of Cardiology. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vasanthi. First of all, I should thank Sri Lanka Heart College of Cardiology for giving me this opportunity to speak about this important topic on heart failure in children. Is it different? So actually, is heart failure in children different? It depends on how you look at heart failure. If you look at heart failure from top, you will see something like this. If you look at heart failure from bottom, you will see something like this. So if we go through your Braunwald's textbook of cardiology, heart disease, the definition according to Braunwald is heart failure is a complex clinical syndrome resulting from structural and functional impairment of ventricular filling and ejection of blood. So if you look at the heart as a pump, which contracts and relaxes, the problems related to it have only two problems. One is heart failure with reduced ejection fraction due to poor contractility. The second one is heart failure with preserved ejection fraction due to poor relaxation. But when I went through the pediatric cardiology definition, it says, a definition from 1913 from Sir James Mackenzie, it says the heart failure is inability to maintain an efficient circulation when called upon to meet the efforts necessary to the daily living of the individual. So it's basically supply versus demand. So heart for pediatric cardiologist is a myocardium. There are valves, vessels and walls. Then you have preload and afterload, which will also determine the output of the ventricle. And to add more to it, you have a circulation or two circulations, pulmonary circulation and a systemic circulation, and another pump on the other side. So it's a bit of a complex issue for pediatric cardiologists. We have a holistic approach to heart failure. So what are the reasons for heart failure? So when you have a different point of view, you have different causes. For us, you have myocardial issues, as you all do. Then we have inflow obstruction issues and outflow obstruction issues. We have holes in the heart, which is the commonest. Then you can have backflow valve regurgitation. Then you can have hypovolemia, which is one of the commonest presentations in children. Then you have arrhythmias as a cause for heart failure. So you have a multitude of problems which can lead to heart failure. So what happens when the heart fails? When the heart fails, there are effects of heart failure. So what are these effects of heart failure? Obviously, you will get effects of low forward flow. Then, when the machine fails, when the pump fails, there will be invariably congestion backward. So you have effects of backward congestion. Then you have the body tries to compensate these two effects. So you have effects of compensation. So what are these low forward flow, effects of low forward flow? Low volume in the aorta will lead to low blood pressure, weak pulses. Due to poor organ perfusion, you will get poor exercise tolerance, fatigue, lethargy, confusion, loss of consciousness, low urine output, even leading to infarction of some of these organs. And low volume will lead to poor oxygen delivery, which will lead to acidosis, low mixed venous oxygen saturation. And backward congestion, if it is left heart failure, you will get the pulmonary congestion, because left heart, the backward is pulmonary circulation, pulmonary edema, crepitations, shortness of breath, VQ mismatch due to rapid drop in saturation. If it is right heart failure, you will see congestion in the systemic veins, enlarged liver, ascites, edema, gut edema, nausea, vomiting, malabsorption, and elevated JVP. Then you have effects of compensation. Body trying to compensate these effects. Body will retain fluid through activation of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone mechanism. There's fluid retention. It will activate sympathetic nervous system. There's tachycardia. Then it will try to redistribute to vital organs, so you will have cold extremities, and to prevent pulmonary edema, it will constrict the pulmonary artery and prevent blood from coming into pulmonary circulation, leading to pulmonary hypertension. So how do we diagnose heart failure in children? Mainly, it's a clinical diagnosis. You have to analyze the effects of low forward flow, effects of backward congestion, and effects of compensation. When you analyze these clinical features, you will get a clue to the lesion. You will also get the severity of the lesion, and you will see how to manage the patient, especially what to do and what not to do. That is very important. In pediatric heart failure, it's very important to know what not to do. So how useful is ejection fraction in assessing heart failure in children? I would say it is mostly useless. I'll show you why. Ejection fraction is assessed using the end diastolic volume of the left ventricle. When it is fully filled, then the ventricle ejects some volume of blood into the aorta and ends up with end systolic volume. So how do we calculate ejection fraction? The stroke volume, the volume that gets ejected into the aorta, divided by the end diastolic volume. That is how we calculate ejection fraction. So, do we actually consider the stroke volume when we calculate ejection fraction? We don't. We assume ejection fraction, the stroke volume, as LV, the difference between diastolic volume and systolic volume. That is the issue. So, stroke volume is assumed as diastolic and systolic volume difference. So, in this case, it is quite over, all right. You get the same ejection fraction. But in this patient who has mitral regurgitation, or in this patient who has VSD, is it the same? Is it the same 60 ml that goes into the aorta? No, it will be only part of that 60 ml. Part will go back to LA in mitral regurgitation. Part will go through the VSD when it has VSD. So when you calculate the ejection fraction in the same manner, do you get the representative vision view of the real cardiac output? No. That is why ejection fraction is not reliable in any of these conditions. It is reliable only in myocardial issues and arrhythmias, but not in any of the other conditions. You can't rely on ejection fraction. It is very important because people refer patients to us and they want us to mention ejection fraction, which has no meaning to it. So what is the purpose? So diagnosis of heart failure in children is mainly clinical. Ejection fraction has no value in most of the time. And echocardiogram, the value of echocardiogram is mainly to identify the cause for that patient's heart failure. So how do we manage heart failure in children? Heart failure management in children, in adults, it is mainly evidence-based, based on randomized control trials. You have enough evidence. But in children, there's hardly any evidence. So you basically go by first principles. So what are these first principles? Both these are pumps. On left hand side, you get a hand pump. The hand pump has a fixed chamber. There's a fixed output. Only way to increase or reduce the output is to change the rate that it pumps. On the other side, right side, we have our left ventricle, which is a flexible chamber, so you can have a variable output. This was first seen by Otto Frank and Ernest Starling. It's called Frank-Starling law, but they didn't get together and postulated this theory. Frank was in Germany 10 years before Ernest Starling, about 100 years back. So what they saw about the left ventricle was this. They said the myocardium within physiological limits, the force of contraction is directly proportional to the initial length of the muscle fiber. So what does that mean? If you plot it, it is like a catapult. If you look at a catapult, it has the same mechanism. If you stretch it more, you can get a greater force, but to a limit. After that, catapult will break. Biocardia will not break, but it will not be efficient. If you plot it, the stroke volume against the end-diastolic volume, you will see when the end-diastolic volume or the filling is less, the stroke volume is less. If you increase the filling, you can increase the stroke volume up to a peak. After that, again, the stroke volume drops. So up to this point, the peak, it is physiological. After the peak, it goes into a pathological phase. So we'll go through one example to see how this happens in real life. Take a patient with a VSD. Obviously, you know now he has a low stroke volume, which will stimulate sympathetic nervous system and activate renin angiotensin aldosterone mechanism. Sympathetic nervous system will increase tachycardia and contractility. Renin angiotensin aldosterone mechanism will cause fluid retention. When there is fluid retention, what will happen? It will try to compensate for loss of stroke volume. It will increase, keep on increasing the LV end-diastolic volume, but when you increase, again, a major portion will go through the VSD. So it will never achieve the optimum level. So it will continue to increase and go into the pathological phase, where we have to intervene, give diuretics, and bring back the ventricle to the normal level. So that is the basis of Frank-Starling curve and application of it in day-to-day practice. So there's not only one curve. This is the baseline normal curve. The heart can have a stimulated situation or a depressed situation, or you can even kill the myocardium. So how do you stimulate the myocardium? If you do exercise, if you give inotropes, if you do afterload reduction, for the same end-diastolic volume, you can have a greater stroke volume. The opposite also can happen with any insult to the myocardium, like myocarditis, drugs, or myocardial infarction, increase in afterload, anything can depress the myocardium, or it can get even depressed if you have cardiogenic shock, where there will be minimal response to fluids. So basically, the Frank-Starling curve has four curves. How we manage our patient is we should try to manage our patient in this area of the Frank-Starling curve. So we will go through a few examples to see how we manage our patients using these basic first principles. First example, this happened to me about 12 years back. I just came after my overseas training, a newborn with a PDA, a private sector NICU. I have diagnosed a PDA, and the pediatrician who is looking after the baby has done some fluid restriction and started on diuretic standard management. After 4 days, I get a call from NICU. Heart rate was 210. Patient was acidotic with poor perfusion. The MO call said it was 6 a.m. in the morning. I was about 2 kilometers away from the NICU. The baby has heart failure. Could it be due to opened up PDA, whether they should give furosemide or whether they should start propranolol, because whether it could be a tachycardia causing this poor perfusion. I was not comfortable. I said, I can come within 5 minutes. I'll come. And as I entered the NICU, this was the X-ray on the X-ray viewer. What is the diagnosis? You barely see a heart. Lung fields were oligemic. This is small heart, oligemic lung fields. And when I did the echo, it was almost an empty ventricle. Fluid restriction, diuretics has caused this. So it is hypovolemia. Where is the patient? If we plot him on Frank-Starling curve, he will be here. So only way to move him up and increase his stroke volume is simple. Give fluids. So we gave fluids and the heart improved, patient improved within few minutes. And imagine that if we have given diuretics or propranolol, what would have happened? Patient would have died, and on the death certificate, they were right, heart failure due to a large PDA. But was it the cause of death? No. So do not treat symptoms and signs. In pediatric heart failure, never ever treat symptoms and especially compensatory signs and symptoms. Treat the underlying pathology which has led to those symptoms and signs. If you see a chest X-ray with microcardia and oligemic lung fields, if you do an echo on that patient, if it is thick ventricles, collapsed ventricles due to low volume, which is called kissing ventricles, always it is hypovolemia. Volume replacement alone is enough to resuscitate the patient. So heart failure in hypovolemia, if you analyze these three basic sets of clinical features, this is one of the rare conditions where you will not see features of backward congestion. You will see features of low cardiac output, you will see compensatory mechanisms, but you won't see features of backward compensation. So if you see features of low cardiac output with compensatory mechanism without backward congestion, it has to be hypovolemia. Second example, another common procedure.
You then review the
a newborn in heart failure, respiratory rate 90, heart rate 180, poor perfusion, chest X-ray dilated heart, echo dilated LV with poor contractility, and obviously there was a cause, aortic stenosis. So what would you do in the initial resuscitation? It's an outflow obstruction. Outflow obstructions are mechanical issues. Most of the pediatric cardiac heart failure has to be managed mechanically because mechanical issues has to be dealt with mechanical solutions. But until we fix them mechanically, we have to manage that heart failure. So heart failure management in children is mostly an interim measure or a bridging therapy. So what do we do until we take that patient to the cath lab? There's poor perfusion, should we give a fluid bolus? There's tachypnea due to heart failure, should we start him on diuretics? There's a dilated LV with poor contraction, should we start afterload reduction, ACE inhibitors or inotropes? There's tachycardia, should we start beta blockers? These are the questions. Where is this patient if you plot him on Frank Starling curve? Cardiomegaly on chest X-ray. So he has to be there. He can't be anywhere else. How do you narrow down further? He has poor ventricular function. So he has to be in this region. Poor ventricular function, cardiomegaly on chest X-ray. If you give fluid bolus, what will happen? When you plot him, you know what to do. If you give fluid bolus, he will further deteriorate. If you give diuretics, there's a chance that he might improve, but these patients are very much load dependent. You can move him slightly towards this side and bring him towards the peak, but any further movement towards left side will deteriorate him further. So better not start diuretics. Best thing is to do a balloon aortic valvotomy and sort it out. Until such time, you can start inotropes if the patient is critically ill. You can ventilate him if he is critically ill. Beta blockers, again, will be counterproductive. What about afterload reducing agents? Will you start afterload reducing agents? The narrowing is at the valve level. What will happen if you reduce the afterload after that? Invariably, it will lead to a drop in blood pressure and patient will die due to coronary ischemia. So, what should we do in this patient? Only inotropes will help. You might ventilate if the patient is critically ill. The third example and the last example is the commonest example that we see in our day-to-day life, heart failure due to a left right shunt. A 3-month-old baby with a large VST, heart rate 160, low volume pulse, respiratory rate 60, significant respiratory distress, saturation 97-98, chest X-ray, cardiomegaly, plethoric lung fields, echo shows large PMVSD with left right shunt. What do we do? We have our whole gamut of therapeutics, diuretics, ACE inhibitors, fluid bolus, oxygen, ventilate, inotropes. What will you do? In this diagram, VSD is, imagine a communication from LV to RV, bypassing the resistance of the systemic vascular resistance. Blood will naturally take the least resistant path and go from LV to RV, then into pulmonary circulation. He will have features of low cardiac output. He will have pulmonary congestion due to two reasons. One is backward congestion, the other one is forward congestion as well, because there's a lot of blood bypassing the systemic circulation, going back into pulmonary circulation. So what determines the shunt in a VSD? You have a VSD here. What determines the shunt? Obviously, the size of the defect. Then, the LV and RV pressure. What determines the LV and RV pressure? LV pressure depends on aortic pressure, which in turn depends on systemic vascular resistance. RV pressure depends on pulmonary artery pressure, which in turn depends on pulmonary vascular resistance. So whatever we do to increase the systemic vascular resistance and drop the pulmonary vascular resistance will increase the left to right shunt. What do we do when a patient like that comes to our ward? We start them on oxygen. If they have low blood pressure, we start them on vasoconstrictors. Will they help? No, they will not help. They will be counterproductive. They will further increase the shunt. But if you start ACE inhibitors, afterload reducing agents, if the blood pressure is acceptable, that is the best thing that you can do. If the patient is moribund, you can ventilate with low FiO2 and high PEEP. High PEEP will open up the alveoli and increase the pulmonary vascular resistance. Low FiO2 is to reduce oxygenation, to prevent opening up of the pulmonary circulation. What about inotropes? Inotropes will increase contractility. When you have a hole, it will increase the flow through the hole as well as into the aorta. So it will increase stroke volume. At the same time, it will increase left to right shunt. So it will not be that helpful. So in a patient with this VSD, ACE inhibitors will definitely help. Oxygen will be counterproductive. Fluid bolus you can give if the patient has come with severe dehydration. And diuretics. So what is the place of diuretics? We always use diuretics when there's a VSD with heart failure. What is the effect? When you have a VSD, you have a left to right shunt with high pulmonary blood flow, and there is more flow to the pulmonary capillary, arteriolar end of the pulmonary capillary. And when the body tries to increase fluid retention through renin angiotensin aldosterone mechanism, it will increase the volume in the left side of the heart, high LA pressure, and that will lead to high pulmonary venous capillary pressure. So there are both sides, the lung is affected. So if you enlarge the alveolar capillary membrane, on one side you have high flow to the alveolar end of the capillary, and on the other hand you have high capillary venous pressure. On both sides, the hydrostatic pressure will go up. You know, the fluid extravasation through this arteriole into the third space depends on Starling forces. Starling forces is hydrostatic pressure and oncotic pressure. When hydrostatic pressure, there's an imbalance like this, there will be more fluid in the alveolar capillary membrane. So this more fluid in the alveolar capillary membrane, the only way to take it out is using diuretics. If it is very severe, if the patient is very ill, you can ventilate with, again, high PEEP and low FiO2, because when you ventilate, the alveoli will open up and it will push that volume back into the circulation. So in this 3-month-old patient with a large VSD, the best thing is to start on diuretics and ACE inhibitors. Oxygen, you shouldn't use. Ventilation and inotropes depends on the clinical condition of the patient. You can combine ventilation and inotropes, but inotropes alone is not a good option. So ladies and gentlemen, what are the heart failure in children? What are the basic principles in heart failure in children? What is the difference? The way we look at heart failure in children is different. We have a different perspective to heart failure. I think it is because you see more cases of heart failure without mechanical issues, and we see more patients with heart failure with mechanical issues. So your stroke volume, your LV end diastolic and end systolic, the difference directly goes into aorta. Ours, it doesn't go into aorta. That is the biggest difference. There are more reasons for heart failure with our definition. It is not only the ventricular myocardium. The way we diagnose heart failure is different, because now you can see echocardiographic assessment looking at the ventricular contraction, looking at the ejection fraction has no meaning to it, no value, because most of the blood comes out of the ventricle but goes somewhere else. And the way we manage heart failure is also different. If we properly manage, mechanical problems have to be dealt with mechanically. And if you manage them properly, you have to put them on the Frank-Starling curve, go down to basics, assess the three sides of clinical features and manage them accordingly. And the way we teach heart failure is also different. During this COVID epidemic, we have created a whole lot of heart failure in children, a lecture series, and that is available. If you can, anybody who is on online, you can go to slcc.lk, go to online training tab. And once you go there, you will be asked to fill this form. You can fill it. There's a payment, but you don't have to pay it. The company who sponsors it, who has provided the platform, has decided to give it free of charge. So after 2 or 3 days or 1 or 2 days, you will get an email giving a username and the password. After that, you can log into the system and start learning. There are courses. There are about 13 lectures on heart failure, from basics to Frank-Starling curve, pump, ARAs, coarctation, MR, MS, shunt, and systolic myocardial failure, all explaining the very basics to the medical student level. And there are many more lectures as well. And if you go to the library tab, you will get the lectures from last 2 years, Sri Lanka Heart Association lectures. All the lectures are there. So, ladies and gentlemen, if I ask you, is heart failure different in children? I think you have the answer. Thank you.
A complex entity made simplified and very interesting. Thank you very much for the excellent lecture, sir. And I wanted to share your lecture today as one of your trainees. There were no questions from the online viewers.
I have one question, sir.
Yes.
So I have one question. I think I have contacted you through the Kaluttara when I had a septic child. It's 6-month-old baby, had a septic pneumonia. He was in the ICU and referred to us, and I did the echo. The LV is dilated and ejection fraction is very low. And baby is not hypovolemic as well. There are no VST or no any cardiac, like no PDA. So they have given enough fluid, and on the fluid even, and we started the captopril small dose. And with that, because of the LV is massive and given a small dose of diuretics, and baby has went to on and off atrial fibrillation and significant tachycardia. And whether to give digoxin at that level, to give amiodarone was on antibiotic, and all the guideline directed antibiotic was there. Then because I have no much experience of how to manage the heart failure, then I decided to contact you, and you encouraged me to give more fluid. And we have increased the fluid, and baby was recovered with our same management actually. And once the child is going to AF, sir, with that, what is your experience on how do you manage that type of child?
Yes, to be very frank with you, I have never seen children going into AF like that. So sepsis is a very complex issue, because you can have vasodilatation, you can have vasoconstriction, and sepsis itself can affect the myocardium. So there can be suppression of the myocardium. So it's a very complex issue. I don't know the reason for arrhythmia, but starting amiodarone, I'll be very careful. I'll discuss with them, because it can further suppress the myocardium. So digoxin in that way is beneficial. I don't know the real reason. Suresh might be able to say something. But digoxin also is very doubtful, but with afterload reduction and some inotropes, you should be able to get away with it.
And we have not started any inotropes, so we just managed with the IV fluid.
And any questions from the audience?
Over to you. Yes, sir. Quickly, Davinder. Do you use, when you are doing echocardiogram in heart failure, children, use the IVC size to assess the fluid filling? That is very useful in adults as well, because as you said, the fluid depletion, not only in children, in the adult also is a big problem. So when you overuse diuretics, you drop the blood pressure, and if you go and scan the IVC, you will see it's almost collapsed.
Yes.
So I think when you are doing an echocardiogram with a heart failure, you have to always look at the IVC. That is very important.
Yes, we use it specifically in ICUs. ICU setup, we always look at the IVC, and they want us to look at the IVC, and we comment on that. Yes, true.
One more thing, as we all know, in adults, heart failure is mainly caused by the ischemic heart disease and hypertension. But
like diseases, but in children it is different, sir. I think it will be important if you tell something on the overall prognosis of heart failure in children, in your experience.
It is mostly, it is a mechanical issue. Once you, it's always a bridging therapy, heart failure. Yeah, because it is mostly either due to a shunt lesion or a valve stenosis or something which we can fix, not like in adult heart disease, which cannot be fixed. You have to manage the heart failure, let the patient live with heart failure. But here you can fix. So except for myocarditis and cardiomyopathies, all other heart failures are, they have good prognosis.
Thank you very much, sir. As the time is up, we should
wind up the session
now. Thank you very much.
Thank you.